गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल. माई सेल्फ मिस्टर टी एम दिवाकर, वर्किंग एज असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन ENDC डिपार्टमेंट इन शरद इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी, कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग, एड्रा इचगंजी. सो वंस अगेन गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल. सो दिस सेमेस्टर आई एम गोइंग टू हैंडल बेसिक ह्यूमन राइट. So before going to start our syllabus, let me know the structure of the basic human right. So for this subject, there is no theory examinations. This subject is only for audit purpose. So we have internal 50 marks for this subject. In that 50 marks, there are two sections. Number one, continuous assessment 1 and continuous assessment 2. So for both these continuous assessment, we have 25 marks and 25 marks. And there are 6 assignments for this subject. So today I am going to cover basic concept. So today we will start chapter number 1. That is a basic concept. In that basic concept, the first point is state. So we are going to see the meaning of the state, what is the definition of the state, and what are the elements of the states. So what is the learning objective of the basic concepts? So after this video, student will be able to learn what is the meaning of the state, how to define the states, what are the elements of the state, and how to explain this. So our first point is meaning. The word derived from the word status, earlier used by German tribes, Teutons. The Greek used the polis to denote the city state, and Roman people used the term civitas, which means state. Hence the term state means an association of people who live within geographical area under the organized government and subject to no outside control. Therefore, the state is an institution to ensure law and order and maintain harmony of social relations. The state has to create the healthy conditions in order to develop the individual personality. It stands for the welfare of society and protect the rights and life of citizens from external and internal threats. Our next point is, what is the definition of the states? So there are different philosophers. They have made different statements for the state. So like Wilson Woodrow, he defined the state is an association of family and their common possessions governed by supreme power and by reason. The state is people organized for law within a concrete definite territory. Second philosopher, Aristotle. Aristotle is the father of politics. He defined state as a union of families and villages having for it its aim a perfect and self-sufficing life, by which we mean a happy and honorable life. Our next point is, what are the elements of the states? So there are four elements of the state. Number one is a population. Second one is the territory. Third one is the government. And fourth one is the sovereignty. So we'll see one by one. Our first element is a population. It is the most important element of the state, because there can be no state without the peoples. So there is no limit for the number of citizens in a state. So the question comes that what is the number of the people in a state? Am I right? So different philosophers, as they are saying that in that the Plato philosopher, he is saying that an ideal state consists of 5040 peoples. How many? So Plato, he is saying that there should be 5040 peoples in ideal state. The second philosopher, Aristotle, has a view that 1 lakh too many. Aristotle is saying that there should be 1 lakh too many. Therefore, his views is that population of the state should be neither too small nor too large. In fact, it should be large enough to the self-sufficing and small enough to be well governed. Whereas the third philosopher, Rousseau, according to his view, he is saying 10,000 populations was an ideal number. So for example, there are some states like Russia, China, India and US which have a big populations, correct? And there are states like Monaco and San Marino, they are a very small populations. Well, there be a belief that the modern states give preference to big size populations. See, once again, the modern state give preference to big size populations, because bigger the population, the greater will be its manpower. In fact, they can fight for a larger period of a time during the war period. For example, Nazi in Germany, fascist in Italy, and communist in Russia encouraged populations to add on to the state while considering the population of the state. We have to study not only the number or quantity, but also the quality of the people inhabiting the state. So according to Aristotle, what he is saying, a good citizen make a good state, obviously, and a bad citizen make a bad state. Next point, he is saying, a good citizen is intelligent, he is disciplined, and he is also a healthy man. In fact, a good citizen not allowed the religions or other circumstances to stand in the way of his duty towards the state. So beside this, the population of the state cannot be fixed, as well as the population of the state need not belongs to a single race or a religion or a language or a culture. In fact, the modern state claim to consist of various groups of citizens. So coming to the next point, so our next element is a territory. A modern state not exist without territory, because the term signifies one's identity, whereas nomadic tribes and gypsies wander one place to another. Therefore, they cannot form a state. When we refer territory of the state, we meet thereby not only the land domain over which the jurisdiction of the state extends, but also rivers and lakes. The CF to its exclusive economic zone and air space above it. Well, there are writers and philosophers who do not consider territory to be an essential element of the state, but in a real sense, the people continue to move from one place to another, having any fixed territory for the residence, then there is no state, for example, gypsies and nomads. The territory aspects of the state is very important. However, there is no clear acceptance as far as size of an ideal state is concerned. For example, Israel, San Mario, Vatican City, they are very small, whereas Russia, China, they have a large territories. There are advantages and disadvantages of the states. The advantages are they remain compact and well governed. But at the same, they are at the great disadvantages in the matter of the national resources. But it makes a state more powerful, and definitely the large state can mobilize its resources for the economics and social welfare and defense of the country. But here is an exceptional like Israel. Israel, in a 6-day war in 1967 with Arab, defeated Egypt, Jordan and Syria. This is the best example. Nowadays, it is possible to maintain their existence and independence, as they always stand in danger by stronger neighbors. For example, Bhutan and China issue of the Doklam. The people love and sacrifice for their motherland. Our third element is government. So no states without government or civilized world. Am I right? So government is the working of the state. It is the political organization of the state. What? Government is the working of the state, and it is a political organization of the state. So according to the Garner, the government is the agency on machinery through which common policies are determined and by which common affairs are regulated and common interest promoted. So authority functions law made and enforced. Justice is dispensed by judiciary organs. Government is the responsible for maintaining law and order. So our fourth element of the state is sovereignty. This is the fourth element of the state. So what is saying sovereignty? Sovereignty means supreme final legal authority above and below which no power exists. Without sovereignty, there is no state in a legal sense. Thank you. So it is a request to all the students. that if you have any doubt, please contact me on a Google Classroom. Thank you.